Hello my dear students, welcome back for today's class History Unit 11 Colonialism in Asia and Africa. In this module we are going to discuss about colonization in Asia, Africa and India and economic impact on British rule. Come, let me move on to the video session.
History Unit 11 Colonialism in Asia and Africa. Colonialism is a process of domination involving the subjugation of one people by another. Like colonialism, imperialism also involves political and economic control over a dependent territory. Colonialism and imperialism. The term colony comes from the Latin word colonus, meaning farmer. This root indicates that the practice of colonialism usually involved the transfer of population to a new territory where the arrivals lived as permanent settlers while maintaining political allegiance to their country of origin. Imperialism, on the other hand, draws attention to the way one country exercises power over another, whether through settlement, sovereignty, or indirect mechanism of control. Colonization of Asia, that is Southeast Asia. The term Southeast Asia has only been used since the Second World War. It denotes the area that originally covered Malaya, Dutch East Indies, Burma, Siam, French, Indochina, and the Philippines. With the exception of Siam, that is Thailand, which remained independent, the area was divided between the Dutch, the British and the French. Malaya Peninsula. When European traders crossed the Indian Ocean at the close of the 15th century, they came for the spices of Southeast Asia. Halbakiu, the Portuguese soldier, who conquered Goa and Malacca, and his successors were interested in the spice trade. After the arrival of the Dutch and the English, there was a challenge to the presence of Portuguese, and the rivalry of these three European powers dominated the 17th century. The Dutch began their conquest of the Portuguese settlement by capturing Malacca in 1641. The Spanish established themselves beginning from their conquest of Manila, which expanded into a larger territory of Spanish East Indies. Anglo-Dutch rivalry. Penang Highland had been brought to the attention of the East India Company by Francis Light. In 1786, the settlement of Georgetown was founded at the northeastern tip of Penang Island. This marked the beginning of British expansion into the Malay Peninsula. By 1826, Singapore and Malacca had been linked with Penang to form the Straits Settlement. Between 1874 and 1895, there was a civil war between the remaining five Malay states. The British intervened and signed an agreement with each of the sultans. In 1900, there were the Straits Settlement, the four federated Malay states and Johor. Economically, Malaya was prosperous.
Indonesia. The Dutch had occupied Java and Sumatra, that is Indonesia, as early as 1640. But they conquered the outer islands of East India only in the second half of the 19th century. Initially, the Dutch were not interested in politics, but focused on exploiting Indonesia ruthlessly. Most Indonesians were fishermen and small peasants and worked on European sugar, tobacco, tea, coffee plantation. Heavy investment in this plantation and other concerns and the discovery of oil in 1900 made Indonesia a valuable colony for the Dutch.
Burma. The British conquered Burma after fighting three wars. Burma remained part of India from 1886 to 1937. Burma was administered by a lieutenant governor with the assistance of a nominated legislative council. Burma teak was shipped overseas. In addition, Burma, with its fertility of soil, became a big exporter of rice, and most of South India was dependent on Burmese rice. During World War II, when Burma fell to the Japanese, South India experienced acute scarcity of rice, leading to a famine.
Indochina. The French conquered Indochina after strong resistance from the people. Starting in 1858, they brought the Indochinese Union under their control by 1887. Indochina consisted of Annam, Tonkin, Cambodia and Cochin China. Laos was added 6 years later. Of them, only Cochin China was directly under French control, that is, as a French colony. The remaining four were protectorates under this system. the local rulers remained, but they governed under the instruction of French residents. Hanoi was the capital of the French government. Rice, rubber, and wheat were the main exports. Laos remained undeveloped. The Philippines. Spain ruled the Philippines for over 300 years, imposing its language, culture, and religion. Consequently, the population became predominantly Roman Catholic. Nationalism developed among the Filipinos during the latter part of the 19th century. There were two serious revolts in 1872 and 1896, which were crushed by the Spanish colonial government. In 1898, however, Spain was defeated by the United States in a war over Cuba, and as a result, Philippines became an American colony. Siam, that is Thailand. Thailand was spared the experience of foreign rule, though it too was greatly affected by the power politics of the Western powers. The administrative reforms of the late 19th century, continuing up till around 1910, imposed a westernized form of government on the country's partially independent cities called Miang. Western powers, however, continued to interfere in its internal and external affairs. Colonization of Africa. Until the last quarter of 19th century, Africa south of the Sahara, that is sub-Saharan Africa, was almost unknown to the outside world. The interior of Africa was unexplored. After 1875, European penetration and colonization began on a large scale. The Berlin Colonial Conference of 1884 to 85 resolved to divide Africa into spheres of influence of the various European powers. European colonization of Africa was thus accomplished smoothly without any outbreak of war among major European powers. The invasion, occupation, colonization, and annexation of African territories by European powers between 1881 and 1914, thereof imperialism, is called the Scramble for Africa or the Partition of Africa. South Africa. In South Africa, the British possessed Natal, Cape Colony, while the Dutch, locally known as the Boers, held the state of the Transvaal and Orange Free State. In 1886, the discovery of gold in the Transvaal led to a large number of British miners settling in and around Johannesburg. The Boers feared and hated the miners, whom they called Uitlanders, that is foreigners. In 1890, Cecil Rhodes, the Prime Minister of Cape Colony, encouraged British expansion to the north of the Transvaal. This worsened the relation between the Boers and the British. Denied of their political rights, the British miners revolted. This led to the Boer War, which lasted 3 years, that is 1899 to 1902. In the end, the Boer army was defeated and Pretoria was occupied. The British annexed the two Boer states but promised self-government in due course. Boer states were given full responsible government in 1907. After discussion over the years, the four states finally decided to form a union and South Africa was created as a state in 1909. Rhodesia. The British South African Company, founded in 1889, conducted an expedition with 600 men. Each of them were promised a 3,000-acre farm. The African king was tricked into believing that all that the Europeans wanted was gold. During the next 10 years, African opposition was crushed. White immigrants were provided with farm lands and railways, and a telegram system developed. The colony came to be called Rhodesia after Cecil Rhodes. West Africa. The coastal states of Gold Coast became a British colony in 1854. Under French West, Senegal had been a French base in West Africa. A later possession of Guinea, Ivory Coast and Dahomey were linked up with the whole area of south of Sahara. Under Congo, Leopold II, King of Belgium, showed interest in Congo, and so the Berlin Conference agreed to the rule of Leopold in Congo Free State. Leopold was forced to relinquish his sovereign right, and in 1908, sovereignty over the Congo passed from Leopold to Belgium. East Africa, under British, in 1886, the possession of the Sultan of Zanzibar were divided into British and German spheres of influence. For the first few years, the British area was administered by the British East India Company,
But in 1895, the British government assumed authority and formed the East African Protectorate, which included Kenya, Uganda and Zanzibar. A large part of Uganda was made up of Buganda, a kingdom ruled by Kabaka.
Portuguese, Angola and Mozambique. The Portuguese had used these two colonies on the west and east coast of southern Africa along with Portuguese Guinea since 16th century.
African rule in Liberia and Ethiopia. Only two countries managed to evade European colonialism, Liberia and Ethiopia. Liberia was formed in the early 19th century as a home for African blacks repatriated from America. Ethiopia, with its traditionally polity, was ruled by the Emperor Menelik.
Colonization of India. Towards the close of the 15th century, Portugal became the first European power to establish a trade link with India. Rounding the Cape of Good Hope, Vasco da Gama arrived in Calicut in 1498. Soon other European powers joined Portugal in establishing their presence in India. The rivalry among four major European powers, Portuguese, Dutch, French and English, the English after three Carnatic War, eliminated the French by the end of the 18th century. The British conquered all the regional powers, in particular the most potential challengers, the Mysore Sultans and the Marathas, by defeating them in three Anglo-Mysore and three Anglo-Maratha War. The conquest of the Gurkhas in 1816, the Sindhis 1843 and the Sikh in 1849 enabled them to emerge as a territorial power in India. The colonialization of Indian economy. We can divide the process of the colonialization of India into three phases. Phase 1, mercantilist capitalism. Phase 2, industrial capitalism. Phase 3, financial capitalism. Let me go through under each heading.
Colonialization of Indian economy, mercantilist phase. East India Company was still a marginal force in India. It relied on concession from Indian rulers for its trading post along the coast. But soon it managed to establish strong ties with Indian merchants who sold their textiles and other goods from the interior. Before it gained dominion in India, the East India Company carried on a very profitable business selling Indian-made cotton textiles and silks and printed cloth. In the 1750s and the early 1760s, Robert Clive gained control of the wealthiest part of the old Mughal Empire. The company exacted concessions such as exemption of company goods from transit duties, which even Indian merchants had to pay. After the Battle of Plassey in 1757, the company got £1.2 million, out of which Clive himself took £31,500, besides the jagir, which provided an annual income of £27,000. After the Battle of Buxar, that is in 1764, the Murshidabad treasury was looted. The company acquired the Diwan right in 1765 and became the revenue farmer of the Mughal Emperor. Industrial capitalist phase, first half of the 19th century, India was converted into a market for British textiles and a great source of raw materials. The company government's expansionist policies led to wars against regional rulers. The cost of this internal conquest was imposed on India. Financial capitalist phase, second half of the 19th century. In its bid to provide an outlet to the investible surplus capital in England, the company government decided to make a massive investment in railroad, the postal system, irrigation, modern banking and education. The capital exported was predominantly for railway construction. The railways helped to move British troops quickly across the country. It also enabled the conquest of the Indian market to the maximum extent. Slavery was abolished in India in 1843 and the system of indentured labor was introduced.
Economic impact of British rule under agrarian conditions. Governor General Cornwallis, himself a big landlord in England, wanted to create landlord in India on the English model. There were already revenue farmers under the Mughals. Cornwallis came to a settlement with them, treating them as landlords. The outcome was that for the first time in India, there was a class of zamindars or landlords with a right to own an inherent land. The cultivators, on the other hand, were reduced to the position of mere tenant. The British deal with the landlords or zamindars directly and gave them total freedom to do what they liked with their tenants. This settlement made with the zamindars of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa is called the permanent settlement in 1793. The royalty system was a different revenue system introduced in South India. Under the system, the peasant was the proprietor and paid tax on the land. The government deal with him directly without the intervention of a middleman or a tax farmer. He was entitled to remain in possession of land acquired by him so long as he paid the land revenue. Land revenue and the pauperization of peasantry. The land tax, which was the main source of revenue to the British, was collected forcibly. Even in times of famine, no remission was given to the peasants. The colonial state pursued a policy of commercialization of agriculture. Commercial crops like cotton, jute, groundnut, oilseeds, sugar cane, tobacco, etc., depending on the market demand, fetched better prices than food grains. So in his bid to clear his debt and to pay up the revenue dues to the state, instead of producing for home consumption, the peasant began to raise crops for the market. He had to depend on the price trend in international markets for selling his agricultural goods. Famine, the policy of free trade and the forcible collection of land revenue resulted in the outbreak of famine. The Odisha famine of 1866-67 was a severe and terrible event in the history of that region, in which about a third of the population died. The famine of 1876-78, also known as the Great Famine of 1876-78, called Thadu Varsha Panjam in Tamil, caused a large migration of agricultural labourers and artisans from South India to British colonies, where they worked as indentured labourers on plantation. The death toll, about 10.3 million, was huge. The memory of this famine is still preserved in various folk songs. Indentured labour. The indentured labour system was a form of debt bondage by which 3.5 million Indians were transported to various British colonies to provide labour for the plantation, that too mainly sugar. It started from 1843, the year of abolition of slavery in India, and continued until 1920.
Now let me go through a short recap. The rivalry of the Portuguese, the Dutch and the English to possess colonies in Malayan Peninsula is dealt with. Spain initially colonizing Philippines, which was later taken by the US, is pointed out. The British settling in Johannesburg and coming into conflict with the Boers, resulting in Boers Wars, are highlighted. French, with its initial possession of Senegal, annexing Guinea, Ivory Coast and Dahomey, Congo being handed over to the Belgians, which was ruled by Leopold, all pertaining to West Africa are detailed. The onslaught of British colonialism on agrarian conditions of India, resulting in impoverishment of peasantry and outbreak of famines, forcing them to emigrate to colonies of British Empire as indentured labourers. My dear students, go through the lesson and learn book back exercise. Take care. Bye-bye.